Not all carbon credits are the same. What does that mean, and how does it all work? Hello, and welcome to the third video in the PERL Eco Carbon Market Education Series. In our previous video, we talked about the standards and the organizations responsible for approving carbon credit issuances. In that video, we mentioned that not all carbon credits are the same, but what do we mean by that, and why does it matter? As we learned in the previous episode, carbon credits can be issued for a range of projects that prevent carbon dioxide from entering the atmosphere in different ways. We previously looked at the different methodologies that are available for issuing carbon credits, and that credits issued within these methodologies have different valuations. So let's learn some more about the different terminology and jargon that you're likely to come across when assessing different PFCs on the PCX exchange. CORSIA-eligible carbon credits are credits that can be used by airlines to offset their carbon emissions under the Carbon Offsetting and Reduction Scheme for International Aviation, or CORSIA scheme. CORSIA is a global carbon offsetting program that was established by the International Civil Aviation Organization in 2016 to help mitigate the carbon emissions of the aviation industry. CORSIA-eligible carbon credits are generated through projects that reduce or remove greenhouse gas emissions from the atmosphere, such as renewable energy projects, reforestation projects, and projects that promote energy efficiency. These credits are independently assessed by a third-party verifier to ensure that they meet the requirements of the CORSIA program. Airlines are considered to be a hard-to-abate sector of the economy. This means the sector will always emit some carbon, even though the industry is working hard to improve efficiency and fuel economy. Commercial passenger airliners powered by renewable energy are likely to be a long way away from being practical. CORSIA-eligible credits will therefore have a long future serving this specific industry sector. When looking at nature-based carbon credits, you will often see some confusing acronyms. So let's take a look at these and demystify some of the terminology. ARR stands for afforestation, reforestation, and revegetation, and is an agriculture, forestry, and land use project category that refers to the establishment of new forests on land that previously did not contain forests or where forests were cleared many years ago. This can include planting trees on degraded or previously deforested land, as well as converting land that was used for agriculture, or the establishing of new vegetation on land that is not forested, such as grasslands, shrublands, or other types of non-forest ecosystems. ARR projects are considered to be carbon removals, as they take carbon from the atmosphere and store it in vegetation and soil. These nature-based carbon removals can be highly valued in the marketplace, as calculating the amount of carbon that is removed follows a fairly simple methodology, although some ARR projects can result in monocropping specific trees and vegetation, which does not support biodiversity, as well as some other activities. APD stands for Avoided Planned Deforestation. The APD approach aims to protect areas of forest that are at risk of being cleared for activities such as agriculture, logging, or mining, and to ensure that the forest remains intact and continues to sequester carbon. This can be achieved through a variety of mechanisms, such as implementing sustainable land use practices, providing alternative livelihoods for local communities, or providing financial incentives for forest conservation. The carbon offsets generated from APD's projects represent the carbon emissions that would have been released into the atmosphere if the deforestation had taken place. APD projects bring additional benefits, such as preserving biodiversity, protecting water resources, and supporting local communities. APD projects are generally implemented where a mining or logging or agricultural business has secured permission from the government to cut down standing forests to either produce pulp and paper, to mine for resources under the land, or to clear the land to plant crops or graze livestock. The big challenge for the project developer is to present an alternative economic case for the land to a concession holder, demonstrating that the carbon credits generated from retaining and improving the standing forest are worthwhile compared to the returns from clearing the land for an alternative commercial use. With APD projects, the initial challenge is making an argument for conservation to one company. But with other projects, you have many more stakeholders to convince. AUD stands for Avoided Unplanned Deforestation. Unlike APD, where the land has been earmarked for clearance for a commercial purpose, AUD is more likely to be implemented where local communities are persistently encroaching onto forest land that is on the border of their town or village. Forest land is cleared, often through slash and burn, to make way for small subsistence farming or small-scale mining by people within the local communities. The biggest cause of this type of encroachment is poverty and the lack of alternative livelihood opportunities for rural communities in developing countries. Credits are generated from AUD projects through careful calculations of previous encroachment patterns and forest cover loss calculations to establish a historic baseline. This allows an estimate to be made of the CO2 that would be released into the atmosphere in future years unless the deforestation ends. Stopping future deforestation, however, is not a simple task and requires a lot of work with local communities to develop new forms of sustainable economic activity through a variety of mechanisms, such as land use planning, community-based forest management, or protected area management. Essentially, a recognition that poverty is driving deforestation, so dealing with poverty is the first step in supporting conservation. There are often many communities near the forest and many individual stakeholders that need to vote on whether a project goes forward. Quality projects work closely with the local communities and carry out many consultations to achieve a meaningful agreement on resource planning and socioeconomic development. Supporting communities and promoting biodiversity is a key aim of all nature-based carbon sequestration projects. There are standards that help to assess this, such as CCB, but we'll leave that for a future episode. So, just to recap what we've covered this week, we've tried to demystify some of the acronyms you will see when looking at different types of carbon credits. You should now know that if the credits are coming from an APD project, then that project is preventing the forest from being cleared for some form of approved commercial purpose, or if the credit is CORSIA compliant, then it is specifically targeting the airline industry. Carbon markets have built up so many of these acronyms and confusing terms, so in advance of the launch of the PERL Eco Carbon Exchange, we're fully committed to helping our community to bust through the jargon and build a proficiency in understanding real-world assets in a decentralized finance context. So, until next time, please like, subscribe, and hit that notification bell so you'll know when the next episode of the PERL Eco Carbon Markets Education Series drops. Until then, thank you for watching, and see you next time.